Randy Stanton, a longtime member of the society. My family began coming to this Northern Virginia Ethical Society in 1985, and my wife, Mary Ellen, and I joined in 1986. Our daughter, Claire, graduated from Nova Sunday School, and I'm glad to say that she continues to be a committed ethical humanist. I've always sought to have a meaningful life, though I've often had to make compromises in order to live in a society where many people have values inimical to mine. Some of the things that have provided meaning to me are relationships with family and friends, education, both formal and informal, my career as a prosecuting attorney, music, literature, and last but certainly not least, my affiliation with ethical culture. Our speaker today is Margaret Placentra Johnston. I've known Margie for almost 30 years, as she and her husband, Bill, joined the Northern Virginia Ethical Society only a few years after Mary Ellen and I. Margie and Bill have two children, Wilt and Tony, who went to our Sunday school and are now computer engineers. Both Margie and Bill were practicing optometrists for many years, and Margie is still working in that field. Several years ago, I heard that Margie was working on a book about spirituality. That book, Faith Beyond Belief, Stories of Good People Who Left Their Church Behind, was published in 2012 and had a huge impact among those who were looking for a new way to look at religion. Faith Beyond Belief was named the gold winner of the 2013 Nautilus Book Award in Religion and Spirituality. I understand that Margie is working on another book, which I'm sure will be a fascinating read. Today, Margie is going to discuss finding meaning. The title of her talk is Meaning Making in the 21st Century American Culture. Here's Margie.
Did you all hear about the seven new planets that they discovered this week? So apparently they're called exoplanets because they're not part of our solar system. And they've discovered so far about 3,500 planets like this exoplanets, but there's thought to be perhaps over a million of them. And apparently scientists were particularly excited about these recent ones because they seem to have conditions that are particularly suited to supporting life as we know it. So when discoveries are like this are made, what thoughts do they bring up for you? Maybe the possibility of travel in some distant future, or a place for humans to move when we've used up all of our planet's resources? Well, for me, such discoveries underline the immensity of the universe, the huge and beautiful mystery that just keeps unfolding new treasures, and according to scientists, is continually expanding. And to me, the perspective offered by such discoveries calls us to adjust our understandings beyond what most of mainstream society holds as truth. So for example, when you go back and read the creation stories in our holy books, particularly the book of Genesis in the Bible, it becomes obvious that the point of reference in that particular creation story is just this earth. Inspired or not, the people who wrote that did not know about the immensity of the universe. So it seems if we're going to adhere to creation stories, we need a bigger story than what's told in the book of Genesis. And I like to explore ways that can help us open our minds and hearts to the bigger story of what life might be all about. And I find many, many factors in today's world are contributing to that bigger story. In fact, I find that a new perspective is emerging in our culture that includes a bigger story surrounding religious belief and spirituality. The problem is that the emerging perspective lacks a name and therefore escapes recognition in our society. And another reason it escapes recognition is that it's multifaceted, very multifaceted, it lacks uniformity, but worst of all, it challenges people to venture outside of any comfortable, easy understandings they may be harboring about our existence here on this earth. Now, when you use the word spirituality, you can conjure up a huge variety of connotations among your listeners, and many of them are a bit negative. So a lot of times it involves people trying to have experiences that help them escape our everyday reality, like out-of-body experiences, or maybe trying to communicate with the dead. Or the word spirituality might conjure up the vision of a lonely hermit meditating all day alone by himself on a mountaintop somewhere. But just go to any gathering of a certain kind of people and you find that they all share some version of a newer, more comprehensive form of spirituality that is not about woo-woo escapes from reality and not based on over-easy wish fulfillment. While this newer awareness lacks an official name, it's sometimes called the new spirituality. And frankly, it is born out of the New Age movement. It's sort of like New Age all grown up. Adherents exhibit a type of spirituality that is deeply connected to our everyday reality, and it is based more on universal compassion and a conscious and an energetic engagement with what is today in the hope of engendering a better tomorrow. This new spirituality is a far more vigorous, more demanding, and conscientious approach to life than most of what happens in traditional religion. And it is also more realistic and more immediate than what most people who reject spirituality could imagine. And the more I get to know people who share this perspective, the more I am convinced that it represents an evolutionary leap in our development of our species, something that was not available to mankind 40 or 50 years ago. And today's talk is meant as an introduction to this perspective for any who may be unfamiliar. And for those who are familiar, I hope today's talk will deepen your appreciation of the implications of this emerging perspective. Now, up until now, human cultures have been blinded because of limited communications between one culture and another, and because most people were dependent on an outer authority to reveal and dispense truth to them in a kind of blanket way. Religious and spiritual understandings may have been relevant to the one culture that developed them, but they would make little sense to people in other cultures. And up until now, we lacked the perspective to see a larger spiritual story that might apply to all cultures and all times. But now we're treated to some new lenses that offer a type of spiritual clarity that was never available before. Taking a bird's eye view, we can see that every civilization in every part of the world, since the beginning of recorded history, has developed some type of religious or spiritual rituals, practices, or beliefs. What, we need to ask ourselves, what were all these people seeking? What basic human need caused all these different cultures to look for something more than what they could see and touch in the everyday world? I propose a number of factors are emerging in today's world that allow us to glimpse an answer to that question, but only if we approach it with a very open mind. So again, the question is, what need has driven all humans to form religious and spiritual perspectives? So I've spoken to this group a few times on the topic of my first book, which was about spiritual development theory. And spiritual development theory is really just one factor contributing to this newer perspective. Now, As far as I know, I'm the first person to have used the term spiritual development theory, but what I did was I took an overview of the work of at least 14 different theorists. There are many more than this, but 14 theorists are mentioned in the book that have all described a process of maturing in a spiritual sense. So these different theories, they came from different parts of the world, different spiritual and academic disciplines, and even different centuries, and yet they were kind of all saying the same thing. They all used different terminology, they all had a different number of stages, but you can always see that they all follow a similar trajectory. Now to simplify this, I talk in terms of four stages, and because they're very counterintuitive, I'm going to present them outside of their normal order, and again, because I have presented this before, this will be quite a quick overview. So the most prevalent stage in our society, or the most articulated stage in our society, is the faithful stage. And this is most of popular religion. Now, popular religion, as preached from the pulpit, is a little bit different from religion as discussed by theologians. Nonetheless, this is what's understood in our society that religion is about. And it's really based on an outer authority. So the truth comes to you through your holy book, or or through your preacher, or you know, something that was divinely revealed. And we say these people are generally pre-critical, meaning they don't go through and analyze, do I really believe that? They just kind of accept it on faith, what their preacher told them. Their beliefs tend to be rather literal. In other words, they believe that Moses really did part the waters of the Red Sea so people could walk through, etc. They believe Mary was really a virgin, etc. So a particular sociological trait of these people is they tend to be ethnocentric. Oh, I forgot to say something. When we talk about spiritual stages, there are two caveats. One, no person is at any one of these levels. We're all just sort of trend. We might be a little more this way, a little less that way, but we all have elements of these stages in all of us. It's sort of like saying someone is an optimist versus a pessimist. You know that no one's always an optimist and no one's always a pessimist in every situation at all times, but having those two words helps us understand something important about ourselves, and it's the same with these stages. Nobody's 100% faithful. Okay, I can see the elements of these stages in almost everyone I know. But anyway, in general speaking, this faithful stage is very prevalent in our society. They tend to be ethnocentric, meaning they see their group as predominant over all the others. Their group is right, their group is more important, they're kind of just focused on their own group. These are generally pretty good people. They're law-abiding, upright citizens, and they're really into following, for example, the Ten Commandments. I mean, they follow these rules in a very literal black and white way. The thinking tends to be binary. Things are either right or wrong. They're either black or they're white. There's very little room for anything in between. So they're not the most sophisticated thinkers, but they are good, upright, upstanding citizens. So that's the first most prominent stage in our society. And when I say our society, I mean Western society, or most specifically the United States. The second most popular stage is the rational stage. These people have a more secular attitude. They have felt free to question religious beliefs, so we call them critical. Where the prior stage was pre-critical, these people are critical. In other words, they don't mind. If everybody in their family believes something and they figure out they don't like it, they feel free to say, nope, don't buy that. So in a sense, their authority comes from something within, more from their conscience than from their group, you know. So I'm sorry if we put these in the wrong place for you, but anyway, so they're critical. They question. They feel free to question religious beliefs, cultural trends, anything. They feel free to figure things out on their own. They have tremendous faith in the power of human reason and the power of the findings of science. So rather than seeing truth as being divinely revealed, they see it comes through from human effort. They tend to be a conscience authority, so they're very principled. You know, they will base on principle, but their principles are a little more sophisticated than the black and white Ten Commandments, you know, so they think things through. A particular sociological trait is that their worldview is a little broader than the prior stage. They're world-centric. This group tends to see themselves as part of the human race. All humans are equal. They tend to be very much into social justice, equal rights, equality for everyone, and kind of they feel themselves a part of all humans. Now, these are the two main levels in our society, the second and the third stage. And they're very much at odds against each other. They very much don't want any part of each other. And I've said in the past that this is what fuels our culture wars. I kind of think that's changing now. I think that it's more of an economic thing fueling our culture wars. But up until now, I'm talking about the past few decades, it has been this religious, you know, either you're in this group or that group, and you don't enjoy each other very much. So part of the reason for that is they don't understand spiritual development theory. So people in that faithful stage, the second out of four, their problem is they don't recognize the rational stage. They don't understand the rational stage. They think that everyone outside of their particular group or their religion is from the first stage, which I'll call the lawless stage, the least developed stage of all. So the lawless stage being the first out of four, again, this is what all people in the faithful stage think everyone else is. They're basically unprincipled. They don't follow the principles, not just of their religion, but their society. They think the rules of society don't apply to them. They're very much into following their own will. They tend to be manipulative, chaotic, and very shallow. When I say chaotic, it means that they don't have any overriding principles that govern their life other than their own will. So, for example, they might espouse one set of values at one time if they think that's what's going to get them where they want to go, and then they might just change their whole value system to something else when they have a different goal. I'm trying not to make this political. But, but anyway, they tend to have a superficial understanding about meaning in human life, and for the most part, they live in misery. That is either material misery or at least social misery, because they don't connect, they don't understand anything about connecting to other people in a conscientious way. So these people are egocentric. In other words, it's all about me. So that's why the faithful level doesn't understand the rational level. They think everyone who's not faithful is lawless. Now, the rational stage, they have a problem too. They think that every religious person is at the faithful stage. So they have no concept of the unitive stage. Now, believe me, I spent most of my adult life as a solid flag-waving member of that rational stage, okay? So when I heard about this unitive stage, I was like blown away. That was brought out in my first book, part of the stories there. These people are quiet. You don't hear anything about them. They don't preach. They don't, you know, they're not egocentric. You don't hear anything about them. But they have this more paradoxical understanding of truth. So they believe, you know, evolution is obviously true, okay? But there's some truth in those creation myths. You know, how they say it, I'm not sure. But they feel more connected. They have a universal sense of connection. Connected with animals, with people, nature, and even they connect to some things that are not visible to the human eye. For example, they might know something just by intuition and they'll trust that, or they might just get the notion that they know something and it's not like they have proof or read anything, it's just something that they get. So they're ruled, where the stage before them, the rational stage, is ruled by a conscious authority, by the conscious mind, something that guides them. These people are ruled by something they might call a spirit authority. They get their information from the ether, so to speak, and that's kind of more true to them than stuff they read in books or things that their conscious mind can figure out. They have a broader worldview than any of these other stages because, again, well, we're going to go through that in a minute, but they also are service-oriented and they tend to have universal understandings. We're all connected, we're all one. So, to summarize, you can look at spiritual development theory as an expanding circle of inclusion. So the lawless level, it's all about myself, they're egocentric. The faithful, it's all about my group, they're ethnocentric. The rational, it's all about all humans and really everything in the everyday reality, including, so to some extent, animals, nature, all that, they're world-centric. And the unitive include all the above, plus there's things that you can't see and feel and touch and hear. So they include all aspects of the universe, so we can say they're unitive, all-inclusive, or universal. To put this one more way, the lawless stage, their mantra could be said to be, it's me against the world. The faithful stage, it's kind of like us against the world. They can know that they're a little bit not as mature because they're always against something. The rational stage is kind of like we are the world, and the universal stage, the universe and I are one. So oneness is really not just for Buddhists, it does play out in all different religions. So spiritual growth can be described as that which draws us outside of ourselves. And an engaged spirituality is really about being maximally connected in the here and now. And rather than focus on salvation in some dubious afterlife, or trying to access some alternative reality, an engaged spirituality is about making the most of life in this world. And understanding that what we do for someone else also benefits ourselves, and what we do against someone else also harms ourselves. And there are many ways that we can connect to something greater than ourselves, and religion, I claim, is just one of them. And that's why a lot of people do fine without a particular religion. To put it another way, spiritual growth is that which draws us outside of ourselves, and it gets us out of what one thing I read used the term tyranny of the self. In other words, it's tyrannical to be just guided by your own will, and when you can spread yourself out to something else and connect to something more meaningful, that brings you out of the tyranny of the self. Now, starting on a whole new concept here, I am not a historian, but based on the authority of people who have written very extensive texts on this, I want to show how whole cultures in the Western world have developed according to these same stages I just described to you. In the time of pre-modernity, I'm going to do this really quickly because again, I'm not a historian and don't pin me on the details. This is just a broad concept. The time of pre-modernity from about the 5th to the 15th century was dominated by people who had really no individual authority unless they were part of the aristocracy. Their understandings were very provincial and parochial, and individuals lacked importance, and it was thought that truth comes to us by divine revelation and played out by the authority of the king or religious leaders. So that was sort of similar to that faithful stage. The time of modernity started with the Enlightenment around 1620 to 1789, and this time they're starting to make scientific discoveries that let them think, whoa, you know, it's not all about what's divinely revealed, but we can figure things out. We humans are important too. We can figure things out on ourselves, on our own. So they developed a tremendous faith in human reason and the conscious, and the individual became very important during modernity. And this kind of extended all the way up until the end of the 20th century, modernity, and it sort of corresponded with the rational stage. Now, modernity has been criticized for having this total confidence in the scientific method and human reason, and they developed sort of a very materialist worldview that everything can be sliced and diced up by science, etc. And it has been criticized as having taken the soul out of the world. And now, we're in the time of post-modernity. So when you say something's modern these days, you're kind of saying it's old-fashioned. Because really modernity is kind of over and we're dealing with whatever post-modernity will turn out to be. Now, you may think that I'm strictly delirious to say that this what's going on now corresponds with some stage of spiritual maturity, connectedness, and universal love. Just turn on the news and you see that's hardly what's going on. But I also want to point out some things that maybe give us hope and see that maybe things are moving in a forward direction, spiritually. So in the time of postmodernity, we have no excuse for provincial, parochial worldviews. We're exposed to cultures from all over the world constantly through globalization, through cultural intermixing. I bet there's no one in this room who doesn't have, who's never had a neighbor or a coworker that was from a different country, different religion. Or possibly even someone marrying into your family of a different culture, different religion. We have worldwide news, you can hardly avoid it. We have the internet where you can study anything you want, so information is not kept segregated from people. You can find out anything you want, pretty much. And so in this type of environment, it really calls us to a position of greater awareness, and the provincial understandings about one culture really don't hold much water anymore. We kind of need a bigger story. We need a bigger religious story, a bigger spiritual story, and probably a bigger cultural story and everything else, but I'm prepared to speak to you about the religious and spiritual things. So we have things going on that give us hope that things are moving forward. At first we have the interfaith movement, which is where different people from different religions would get together and just tolerate each other. They would just talk, but they weren't really comparing, they weren't trying to draw conclusions, they were just kind of respecting each other's beliefs. But then, even before that, there's some people did this writing about what they call a perennial philosophy, which was designed to show that all religions have a common core and all religions are kind of headed in the same direction. And now we have something going on called interspirituality, where they're showing that, yeah, actually all religions do have a, not just at a theoretical level, but in the heart, there's a similarity amongst all religions. So, it leads us towards this thought that perhaps each founder of each of our religions gave a system that worked for that time and that location. So perhaps it is that each revelation and what they think their religions were revealed, each revelation was perhaps meant for that time and that place. But the purpose of each of these revelations was an attempt to fill, for the sake of that one culture that developed, to fill a timeless, basic, timeless, and universal human need. Now, what would that human need be? Now, we're going to go back and look at spiritual development theory. Spiritual growth is that which draws us outside of ourselves. So, the bigger spiritual story could be that the timeless and universal human need that drives the formation of all religions and all spirituality is the desire to connect to something greater than ourselves. And I claim that this can be met in any number of different ways. Religion is only one of them. Now, this is my, just kind of, my summary of these things. The faithful level, they can connect very well through their own religion, their church, their God. Okay, that helps them connect. That's a good thing for the most part, except when they use it as a weapon against others. I claim that the rational stage gets a very good sense of connection, connecting to something greater than themselves through flow activities. I don't know if you're all familiar with this psychologist, Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. He wrote a book a while back called Flow, The Psychology of Optimal Experience, in which he described activities, an optimal state of engagement where the activity is optimally balanced against, this level of skills is balanced against the level of challenge. So in other words, if you have high skills and activity is too easy, you get bored. If you have low skills and the activity is very challenging, you have anxiety and frustration. But if they're maximally balanced, you can get into this flow state where in this state, time and all your worldly concerns drop away. So you could be tired, hungry, cold, bored. You know, not tired, hungry, cold, whatever. But you don't even think about that because you're so engaged with this activity. Now, some of us are lucky enough to have that through our career. It might be through our hobbies. It could be through sports activities, art, music, connection with your family, your community activities. There's a million ways you can get into a flow state, and I think that many of us in the rational stage can connect to something greater than ourselves through flow activities, and therefore don't feel the need for that, you know, religion in a box that some people do. It's a more creative approach. Now, remember that I said everybody has a little bit of all these stages, so when I say that the unitive stage tends to